Hello, my dear friends. Let us continue with the cyber law. I am Rajagopal, faculty and law practitioner. In the previous class, we have discussed about some of the important provisions in the IT Act 2000. And then the different types of digital signatures, electronic governance, use of electronic records, retention of electronic records, and publication of rules and regulations, and who is having the power to make the rules. So today in this class, we will discuss about the attributions and acknowledgements, dispatch of electronic records, secure electronic records, and the last, secure digital signatures. Okay. As I have clarified in the last class itself, we will discuss in terms of the sections what the law tells about the different issues, in which section of IT Act this particular thing has been clarified, and how we have to act accordingly if we are dealing with any of this particular information technology related things. Either it may be a dispatch of the data, security of the data, security of the digital signature. What the law says about this particular thing is very important at this point of time. All of you being a technical students, you have gone through the technology part of it in the previous discussions with a few subject experts. Here in this module we are looking at what law says, how we have to secure, what we have to do, okay, all these things in this today's discussions. Okay, let us quickly go to the next slide. The first part is attributions, that is there in the section 11 of the IT Act. Section 11 of the IT Act will tell you, that is already we have entered into the fourth chapter of the Information Technology Act. Here it will be here in this fourth chapter we are discussing about the attribution, acknowledgement and dispatch of electronic records. IT Act 2000 in chapter 4 we will going to discuss about this particular concepts. The section 11 of the IT Act will mainly brings us to the attribution part. Attribution means from whom, who is responsible for this particular records or particular data or whatever may be, on whose name this has been generated. Okay, that we will call it as an attribution. Okay, so here the electronic record, e-record, whatever we call, shall be attributed to the originator of that particular record. Originator is a one person who has sent that particular document. If it was sent by the originator, it is attributed, it was sent by the originator. And then a person who is authorized by the originator. Okay, we can authorize. If I am the originator, I can authorize some other person to send a particular data at that particular point of time. For example, a manager of a company, if he want to send some circular to all his employees, then he can appoint or he can give an authorization to his deputy manager to send this particular circular in the following instances. So then the person who has got an authorization will be the originator of that particular e-record or particular document. or otherwise in some other issues, it can be a programmed. A system may generate at that particular of time, a particular circular has to be sent, means a system may generate it and it can send it automatically. So then it will be an attribution of that particular originator. A programmed system will be the originator of that particular data. So attribution in the section 11, it is clearly told that it is either it may be sent by an originator or an authorized person on behalf of the originator or a programmed system on behalf of the originator. Here the law gives the provision in all the ways. Okay, in real time, what will happen? We may send the data, or we otherwise we can authorize, or there may be some automated system which will generate certain data and it can be sent automatically. So the originator will be having the attributes for that particular e-records. That is clarified in the section 11 of IT Act 2000. Okay, next. Is the next question is which comes is the acknowledgement of receipt, we can call, which is discussed in the section 12 of IT Act. First thing, in section 11 we have discussed about the attributes, or the originator will send the e-record. Here in law, any record sent to a person will complete by an acknowledgement received by that particular person. For example, the court will send a notice to a particular person to attend the hearing before a particular authority on such and such date. Okay, if it is received by that particular person, then he has to send an acknowledgement. Okay, if he has sent an acknowledgement that I have received that particular letter from the court, then he is bound to attend that particular session before a particular presiding officer on that particular day. If he fails after receiving the acknowledgement, then the action will be taken against that particular person. That is one thing that we have to keep it in mind. Acknowledgement is one instrument where it will be sent by the receiver after receiving the data. So here, whenever we send the e-data to a particular person, e-record to a particular person, it is very much necessary that whether we have received an acknowledgement from that particular person. Okay, if he has received, then the process will complete, the chain will complete and the process will complete, then we can go to the next step. If there is no acknowledgement from the receiver, then that process will be treated as incomplete, and then again we have to take some steps to send the record once again, letter once again, so that it will reach the particular addressee. So here in the same thing is discussed in this acknowledgement, the section 12 of the IT Act. There is a clear thing in some other sections, how the hard copy will be sent, how the acknowledgements should be received, all these things. Here we are discussing in terms of e-records, electronic records. If a mail is sent to a person, I am taking one example, if we send a mail to a particular person, then there will be an indication that he has received. That is sufficient, that will be considered as an acknowledgement. Okay, that will be considered as an acknowledgement. Or otherwise, he can reply to that mail telling that I have received this particular letter, I am taking such and such action on this particular letter. That is a communication by the addressee. That is also very much sufficient. So here the acknowledgement may be any communication by the addressee. Addressee may communicate to the sender that I have received, or any conduct of the addressee. Conduct means if he has received, he has checked the mail, then that is sufficient that it has, we can understood that he has received the mail. One best example that I can give you at this point of time, my dear friends, we are very much used to this WhatsApp. There we will send an information. Once if it is sent, text message, if it is sent, then there will be a one tick in the sender at the box, sender box in the right side bottom corner. I think all of you have observed it. Okay, there will be a one tick mark telling that you have sent, the sender has successfully transmitted the message. Okay, if there is a double click, then it is an indication that the receiver has received, the receiver instrument, we can tell, receiver mobile phone has been received this particular data what you have sent. If that instrument is switched off or it is not working, then you will be having only one tick telling that it is sent by you but not received by the receiver. If there is a double click tick mark, then you can understand that it has been received. Once if he has checked, the color will change, the double tick mark, the color will change that he has checked. That is sufficient, that will be considered as an acknowledgement. So he may not have gone through the entire message that you have typed. Okay, whatever may be, that is not our botheration. But the thing is, he has received that information, that acknowledgement is sufficient. Okay, so that is in the section 11 of that, section 12, the acknowledgement received, where the originator has not stipulated that the acknowledgement of the receipt of the electronic record be given in a particular form or by a particular method of an acknowledgement. Either it may be a communication by the addressee or any conduct of the addressee. That is very much important. That is clearly given in the section 12 of the IT Act. Any, he can communicate that I have received, or otherwise any conduct of that addressee is sufficient to assume that he has received that particular record. The second condition, okay, what is there in the section is, the originator has stipulated that e-record shall be a binding on the receipt. If he has that e-record that is sent, if there is a binding only on the receipt, means if it is complete, if we have to assume that that is complete, only on the acknowledgement based on sent by that particular person is the basis, means then we have to wait for that particular acknowledgement. Okay, if it is not binding, okay, so third point here what we are discussing, in the section 12 is, if it is a not binding, not stipulated on e-records shall be binding only on the receipt. Okay, if it is not stipulated, okay, if it is not clearly mentioned, okay, then we can go ahead with the next step, whether that act of reception is sufficient. That is what the law says in the section 12 of the IT Act, how to receive an acknowledgement, how to treat that, whether particular person has received or not received an that particular e-document, that is clearly mentioned, and then how we have to proceed with that, that is very much important. Here, my dear friends, in any of the law, a person has to be intimated properly, okay, while taking certain actions. For example, the government want somebody to attend some work. Let us take one example of election duty. Okay, if there is a general elections or any sub elections or whatever may be, the government will take his employees for certain work. they will be appointed in different cadres at different place. An information will be sent to that particular person through the circular that you have been appointed. Here I am taking just as an example. You have been appointed for that particular duty. You have to attend the training program on such and such date. Okay, all these details will be mentioned in the circular and it will be sent to that employee who is working in a particular place. Then there exists the acknowledgement, whether he has received that letter. Okay, he will send an acknowledgement. That nowadays it will be sent through the SMS or WhatsApp or whatever may be. While sending an SMS, at the time the employer's mobile may not be in a good condition, then he will not receive that letter. Then we can't go against that person telling that you have not attended the particular duty. Okay, then it will be against to the law. That is clearly mentioned here. He, after receiving or by his negligent conduct, if he neglects that government circular, then the action may be proceeded against that particular person. That's why the law tells how an acknowledgement should be received, okay, and how we have to assume and how the law will assume whether that person has received the communication sent to him through the mail or whatever may be, through the web or whatever may be, through the telecommunication media. Then we can go further. Okay, if he has received and if he has neglected that duty, then the action may be proceeded. He can be processed with that particular further action what he has to be taken. So here the law clearly tells how to send and who is eligible to send, who is the originator, and how to receive an acknowledgement. That is a clear mention in the IT Act 2000 in the listed in the section 12 of the IT Act. Okay, so with this we have discussed who is the originator, who can send the data, and how he has to treat that a particular person has received that particular data. So here the next thing is time, place, dispatch and receipt of the e-records. My dear friends, we will send the data. Previously, when there is no email communication or web-based communication, whatever we can tell, we used to send the letters through the post. We used to rely upon the all the government agencies or private agency used to rely upon the government postal department for the communication, for written communication. Then we used to send the letter or a circular. Then the acknowledgement, if it is a registered post, then after receiving the acknowledgement, the process is said to be complete. When he has received, there may be a postal delay. Okay, when he has received, at what date he has received, at what time he has received, all these plays a very very important role. Okay, if there is not so important circular, means if the time and date of dispatch and date of receipt is not a criteria, then it is not then nothing will happen. If that is a very important thing, okay, then what law says? Time and place of dispatch of receipt of e-records. Okay, that is under section 13 of IT Act. There is a clear mention of how to give weightage to the time and place of dispatch and receipt of e-records. Okay, time and place of dispatch and time and place of receipt of e-record, all these things are clearly mentioned in section 13 of IT Act 2000. Okay, time of dispatch, unless otherwise agreed between the originator and the addressee, the dispatch of the electronic record occurs when it enters a computer resource outside the control of the originator. Here in this IT Act, it is clearly mentioned that whenever the dispatch of an electronic record occurs when it is enters the outside the control of the computer originator, means if he has transmitted message, then that will be considered as, then it will be considered as he had, the message has been dispatched. Okay, the message has been dispatched from that particular originator. Okay, that message has been dispatched. Okay, next. Let us go to the next slide. Okay, time and place of dispatch of when the time, okay, time of dispatch is considered as in the time when it enters outside the computer of the originator. Okay, that will be considered as time of dispatch at the time, at the date he has dispatched the e-records. Okay, that will be considered. And the time of receipt is very much important, my dear friends. Okay, here the section 13 will clearly tell what is the time of receipt. If the addressee has designed a computer, okay, the first thing is, if he has received, he is a person, if he has received, okay, then that will be considered as time of reception. Okay, it will be a few seconds or whatever may be. It will be sent to that particular person's mail account. Okay, any action will be treated as time that he has received the acknowledgement. Time he has received that particular action. As I have given the example of WhatsApp, whenever he checks that message, whether he has read that message is a different question. The time when he checks will be declared, will be treated as the time of receiving the particular record. Okay, that is one case if it is an individual. For example, you have sent an application form to a particular department for appointment, for any other purpose, you have sent an application. There will not be any person who will receive. There will be a designated computer. A last date and time will be specified, and such date, such and such time, your application should reach. Otherwise, it will be disqualified. Otherwise, that application will not be considered. Okay. There, each and every minute is very much important, and there a designated computer will be there which will receive the application forms, n number of application forms from different places of the state or the country. Then the time will be considered as the time it enters the designated computer, the time when ER enters the system. So there will be a last date of filing the income tax return. Time will be there. Okay, nobody will be there. 12 o'clock it will be given as night. 12 o'clock is the time. At the time it has to enter. Such and such date, 30th March, some year, at 12 o'clock. Means the receiving computer will be receiving. Okay, the time is considered as when it enters the designated computer. Okay, at that time when the addressee receives, if not sent to the designated system, if he receives or sent, that will be treated as the time of the receipt. Okay, if the addressee has not designated a computer, the time when ER enters the computer will be considered as the time of receipt of e-records. That is clearly mentioned in the section 12 of the particular IT Act. Section 12 of the IT Act will clearly gives the time and place of the receipt of the e-record. There are different subsections will be there. Okay, how the particular data is treated as received or not received. Okay, we can go in detail. And the time of dispatch, again the same thing as mentioned in the section 13. The time will be whenever it enters outside the control of the originator, that will be treated as this. And then place of dispatch, from where it has been dispatched. If it is from a particular person, it will be treated as his place or his residential address, or whatever the address he gives will be treated. If it is a business, then it is a different issue. The place of dispatch will be considered as the place where the originator operates his business. Okay, the place where the originator operates his business will be considered as place of dispatch of e-records. For example, if the originator has different places of operation, for example, a company is having its offices in the different places of the globe, then how to treat the place of dispatch? Okay, how to treat the place of dispatch? If nothing is mentioned, if it is mentioned that we are sending from the Bangalore office, no problem. If it is mentioned that we are sending from abroad locations, it is understood in a similar manner. If nothing has been sent, there are some cases. Okay, so to keeping that in mind only, the law has been designed like this, my dear friends. Okay, then it will be considered as, then the purpose of this section, principal place of business, okay, that is the head office, will be considered as the place of dispatch of e-records, or usual place of residence, as we have discussed, the place of residence, and place where it is registered. Okay, place where it is registered. Okay, in the company will be registered in a particular name, that will be treated. That name will be treated. Okay, the registration, place of registration will be treated as the place from where the record has been dispatched. From where the e-record has been dispatched. That is considered as place of dispatch of e-records. Then it comes, the section 14 will comes, how to secure the e-records. What do you mean by a secure e-records? Okay, so the definition will tell where any security procedure has been applied to an electronic record at a specific point of time, then such record shall be deemed to be a secure electronic records. From such a point of time to a point to the time of verification. Okay. For example, we are sending a document in a sealed cover. Okay. Let us come out of the electronic records. We want to send a document, an application form, to a government agency for some purpose. Then we don't want anybody to open that in between. What we will do is, we will put a seal, we will give a mark to that particular seal, and then it will be sent. Okay, so that is a secure record. If there is a disturbance, then that will be considered as it has opened in between. If there is no such thing, means till the time of verification, that record is considered as secured electronic record. Okay, nobody should open that particular record. Nobody should open that seal. Similarly, e-records also, if it is attached, okay, if it is attached with some signature or if it is attached with some mark, then it will be considered as a secure electronic record. And that if that is opened in between, then it will become illegal. Okay, the law will take its own action against that. Okay, so here the secure e-records in the section 14, okay, in the section 14 it is clearly mentioned that how an e-record should be secured. So in this section 14, section 15 will tell mainly about secure e-records and secure digital signatures. Okay, so here the secure e-records means a security is provided for an electronic record when it travels through the medium, okay, other than the authorized person should not open that particular record. An authorized person, authorized agency should open that particular record. That is known as a secure e-records. Okay, that is one thing. To secure these records only, there are different agencies. For example, Government of Karnataka is having HRMS, Human Resource Management System, where the electronic records of a particular person will be maintained the time when he enters into that particular service. All his database, when he has entered into the service, okay, when the increments are given, when the punishments are given, okay, all these things will be there in that particular HRMS system, Human Resources Management System. That is a secure e-records. Records will be secured here in this particular system, and there will be a particular person who will be maintaining that particular records. Okay, that will also be there. Okay, section 14 will clearly mentions how the security will be given to a particular records, e-records, how it will be considered as a secure e-records. Okay, so coming to the section secure e-records and section 15, as we have discussed, see my dear friends, section 14 onwards, that will be considered as the chapter 5 of the Information Technology Act. Chapter 5 we will discuss about the secure e-records, secure digital signatures and many more sections. Okay, let us come to the secure digital signatures, that is given in the section 15. An electronic signature shall be deemed to be a secure electronic signature if the signature creation data at the time of affixing the signature was under the executive control of the signatory and no other person. Okay, so here the digital signature, in the last class while discussing about the digital signature, I have clarified that a digital signature a person can have or a person can authorize that he can do the digital signature. That's why here in the section 15 will clearly tells the signature creation data at the time of affixing the signature if it is under the control of a particular person. Okay, then it will be considered as a secure digital signature. Okay, for example, while signing, if somebody forges your signature, then that will not be considered as a that will not be considered as your signature. Okay, why? The court will ask the evidence. For example, if some unauthorized person sends the data or a company employee sends the data by misusing the digital signature of the directors. So at that time, if the directors can prove that if that digital signature was misused by some other employees, then that will not be considered as a secure digital signature. Whatever the signature that has been done at that particular point of time will not be considered as a secure digital signature. It will be considered as forged signature. So that's why section 615 will clearly tells that as long as digital signature is there with you, that is your responsibility to have the signature, the digital signature with your safe custody. So somehow, due to some problem, if somebody has misused that, then that will not be a secure digital signature. That is given in the section 15. Okay, second point is the signature creation data was stored and affixed in such exclusive manner as may be prescribed. Okay, there are some manners that we will discuss in the later part of this particular act. Okay, how we have to secure the digital signature, how to maintain the digital signature, and all these steps are followed, then it is considered as a secure digital signature. If there is a lapse in maintaining the digital signature, then it will not be considered. So the section 15 will clearly tells you about how to maintain, how, what is considered as a secure digital signature. Okay, what the law tells about the secure digital signature. Creation of digital signature, there is a few concepts will be there. Okay, how to maintain the signature, digital signature, there are certain points that we have to follow. If it is followed, if that particular steps are followed while maintaining the digital signature, then it will be considered as a secure digital signature. If it is not followed, then it will not be considered as the secure digital signature. Similarly, the electronic data, secure electronic data, as steps will be given, how we have to maintain the electronic data, what are the procedures that we have to follow while maintaining the electronic data. So if that steps are followed, then it will be considered as a secure data. If there is a lapse in following the certain rules and regulations in maintaining that e-records or a digital signature, then it will not be considered as a secure data or signature. Okay. So, as I have told, what is the procedure? Security procedure. The central government will give the security procedure that you have to follow for the purpose of sections 14 and 15. So, previously I have told my dear friends, you have to maintain a procedure to maintain the e-records or to maintain the digital signatures. Okay, then only it will be considered as secure e-records or secure digital signatures. Okay, that authority, that procedures, or altering the procedures, what should be the procedure to maintain the e-records, what is the procedure to maintain the secure digital signature, that authority is there with the central government. Timely it can be changed. Okay, depending on certain aspects, it can change that. The procedures it can change. Okay, let us see one by one. The central government may, for the purpose of section 14 and 15, prescribe the security procedures and practices. First one is based on the nature of transaction. It can tell how we can maintain the e-records or digital signature, nature of transactions. If it is not of so important, if the data or record is of not so important, in the last class I have told, a digital signature can be, there can be a mention that if you are downloading a software or if you are downloading an application, then it can be a tick that I agree with the terms and conditions, then that is sufficient. That can be considered as a security. Okay, that is sufficient. Some in while using the credit card, there can be a password. They can ask you for the password. That is sufficient. Okay, if there is a some so higher sophistication is required, then there can be a thumb impression or a biometric information that is necessary. Then still if you want more, then we can go for a digital signature. So depending on the level of sophistication, depending on the level of security that has to be given for a particular data, the central government can give may make the provisions for Article 14 and 15. And the volume of transactions, based on the volume of transaction also it can be security procedures can be made, and the availability of alternatives. What are all the alternative sources which are available for providing the security? What are all the alternative sources? Means to say, here the main advantages we have listed. A disadvantages of this e-records or digital signatures or e-transactions or cyber transactions is, in some parts of our country we cannot completely go into the digital services. Okay, there will be people who are illiterate, who are not having the knowledge of using, even though it is simple, they will not be having, they are not exposed to the cyber world. Okay, then we have to take care of them also. That is the main intention of a law. While designing a law, the lawmakers has to go into the different aspects, have to look into the different aspects. What is the majority of the people used to? What is the majority of the people accessed to? All these things they have to observe and they have to make a law. So, herely the availability of alternatives. How other way it can be worked out to reach the maximum strength of population? That also is very much required while installing the security procedures, and the cost of alternative procedures. Means everything while making the law, we can give the highest level of sophistication or security or whatever may be. What is the cost involved? Finally, the burden will be on the people, on the common people. Whether all categories of people can afford that is the important question. So, cost of alternative procedures. Cost is also important while implementing any of the law. And the procedure for the general use of similar types. If the similar types, what are the other procedures that are in use? That also should be looked into while doing any of the procedures in terms of law. While designing any of the procedures in terms of law, we have to look into all these aspects. So here, while designing the security procedure for the cyber law, the section 16 will clearly tells what the central government will look into while implementing the procedures, security procedures for securing the e-records or signature or whatever it may be. What are all the things that it will look into? That is the nature of transaction, level of sophistication, volume of transactions, availability of alternatives, cost, and the procedure which is similar in use will be looked into while taking care of these things. Okay, so with this, my dear friends, we have discussed the chapter 4 and 5. Okay, both the chapters we have discussed, chapter 4 and 5, different sections of Information Technology Act 2000, how we have to secure the data, how we have to secure the signature, what are all the procedure for sending the data, acknowledgement of the data, everything we have discussed in this class. Okay, my references is your prescribed book and the Information Technology Act 2000. With this, we will conclude this session for today. Thank you very much.